Good morning. It is so good to see your smiling face in the house of the Lord. We're so thankful that you have chosen Burlington Bible Church to worship God this morning. We're excited to see you here. Psalm 34, verse number 8 says, "O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him." This morning as we worship, let's magnify the Lord and let's trust in him as we worship him this morning. Let's stand and invite the Lord this morning. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the opportunity that we have right now to magnify your name. You are so worthy, and we want to give you praise this morning. You are good, and we want to be a blessed people. We want to trust in you. Would you help us as we worship you this morning in your name? Amen. Remain standing as Randy comes and leads us in our singing.
Amen. Thank you for those that decorated the Faith Builders class. Very nice. Let's do pray for Sister Stamford as she is in junior church. Now it's her turn to take over, and it's got it beautifully decorated. But let's pray for our young children, Lord, as they're down there, that this is a great part of our church. And I thought they'd done it for us, but evidently it wasn't. So anyways, get a course book. Turn to number 15, page 4 there. How big is God? How big is your God? Is he big enough? Amen.
Big
the total package this morning. Amen. He will meet your every need. Praise his name. I trust he's real to you this morning. Let's turn to number 98. Let's sing about our great Savior. Amen. Aren't you glad for what he's done for us? What he wants to do. Praise his precious name. Number 98. Hey! glad for that, that grace that he's granted us this morning. Praise his name. I am his and he is mine. Aren't you glad for that this morning? Praise his name. Amen. Let's turn on over to number 78 there. Praise him. Praise him. Amen. You're singing good this morning. Praise his name.
Appreciate that expression of praise. Anybody else want to give God praise this morning? Right back here. Amen. Wonderful. All right. Anyone else? Your heart is overflowing with praise. Nikita, go right ahead. Amen. Praise God, Nikita. All right, right here. Amen. Yes, good. Right here, Shamika. Amen, Shamika. Good. Good testimony. Brother Marvin.
He's been my helper this week.
Wonderful. That's exactly right. Praise God.
Had an unusual number of things to accomplish. I do not know how. I have no idea. But I'm sure he many, many times have prayed and asked for wisdom, for direction, helping get things done. And
Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Yes. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Well, there is so much to thank God for. All right, Ellison, you're waving at me. You got a testimony? All right. She says she loved Daddy. Oh, thank you for that testimony, Ellison. Oh, we have so much to thank God for. Somebody's pointing somewhere else. Marshall? Amen. Good. All right, Carrie. Amen. Praise God. Evan.
I'm so thankful that just as we sang in one of our songs this morning, that God is our strength and weakness.
Yes.
And so we face temptation.
Praise God.
His strength and provision that we can be victorious.
Amen. Praise God, Evan. Praise the Lord. Well, I don't care how you feel this morning. I mean, I do care. But he is worthy of our praise. You may have come in discouraged. You may have come in defeated. You may have come in hurting. You may have come in, many, many different ways. But all of that is immaterial in the fact that he is worthy of our praise. And we just sang some wonderful songs. I'm telling you, there's so many things I was thinking as Randy was leading us in Our Great Savior. There are so many things in that hymn that ought to make us say, hallelujah, what a Savior. Beginning with, he hath granted me forgiveness. I am his and he is mine. Well, we can still say, hallelujah, what a Savior, even if you're discouraged this morning. If you have that awareness on your heart that God has forgiven your sins, oh, we can say, hallelujah, what a Savior. And then on top of that, friend for sinners, strength and weakness. Oh, and then even in hymn number 78 that we sang, so many wonderful things that we can give God praise for. So thank you for your expressions of praise this morning. Brother Doug? Absolutely. Oh, I thank God. I thank God for his presence and what these songs communicate to our heart. It ought to well something up inside of us that just says, Lord, no matter how I feel, no matter what's going on in my world, I still choose to praise you. I choose to give you praise. Amen. Well, why don't we sing this little chorus together? Maybe we can do it a cappella. I will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for slain. Give him glory, people, for his blood. Sing it through one more time, and I want to encourage you, maybe even if you don't feel like it, go ahead and praise him. I will praise him. Oh, he's worthy this morning.
I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners slain. Give blood can Blessed be the name of Jesus. I'm so glad he took me in. He's forgiven my transgressions. He has cleansed my heart from sin. I will praise him. I will praise him. Praise the Lamb for sinners.
Let's praise in him. Let's praise him this morning. Praise him this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Anybody else just want to give God praise? The Lord. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Amen, Brother Marvin. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God, Brother Marvin. So grateful for the Lord's touch on Brother Marvin after a little difficulty here this past month, but we're thankful for the Lord's touch. Amen. Praise the Lord. Any of the other kids want to give God praise? Because I'm going to dismiss you to go to junior church, but if you want to praise the Lord before you go, you can. All right, we're going. All right, right here. Go right here. Amen. Oh, it's hard to believe, isn't it? Hard to fathom. But he loves us. And that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. All right, the children can go to junior church. The Lord bless them. And this is a brand new theme, and so this is going to be exciting for each of them. And we sure love our children here at Burlington. And I just want to say a special thank you to Felicia. Felicia is just finishing up, kind of wrapping up a theme down there, and now Brittany is taking it for the next 10 weeks or so. And so I know Brother Randy already mentioned something about the decorations down there, but she put a lot of time and effort into that. It looks wonderful, looks great, and I wouldn't be surprised if some of you just head down there one of these times when I dismiss the kids. But I want us to be praying for Brittany and her helpers, and the Lord will continue to use Junior Church and minister to the lives of our children. Amen. Yes. Thank you. Let's be praying for our junior church ministry that the Lord would use it to impact these kids. Yes, Tyler. Sure. Praise God, Tyler. Praise God. Praise God, Tom. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Yes.
I don't want to take up the customs here.
Sure, that's
and
right.
I'm glad that I don't have any desire to take part in the things of this world and the pleasures of this world. And I've got my eyes set on
praise God, Tyler. Amen. Praise God, Tyler. Thank you for that testimony this morning. That just kind of goes right along with the theme I started last Sunday night. Some of you weren't here for that, but talking about victorious living in exile. You know, we are, as Tyler alluded to, we're different. We are different, aren't we? And so we are living in exile, but we're headed home. But until we're home, we can have the testimony of living victoriously right here. And so may God continue to help us. Thank you for that testimony, Tyler. Let's just keep praying for Tyler, and let's keep praying for one another, that the Lord would help us in our spiritual journey. And as I was mentioning also, the junior church, let's pray for Brittany and all of those helpers that are ministering down there. And they are giving of their time and talents and advancing the kingdom of God in this way. And I want it to make a huge difference in the lives of our children, so let's be praying for them. We do want to pray together, and I'm going to ask Brother David Stamper if he will lead us in just a couple of moments. And I have some requests here that I want to mention, then I'll give you the opportunity if you have some that you would like to share that the church family can help you pray about. I'll give you a moment to do that as well. But a couple requests that I have down, I want us to continue to pray for Betty Lawson. Betty is undergoing some tests. The doctors are a little confused. She's had quite a bit of pain in her legs, and they're trying to figure out what it was or what it is. The doctors have kind of thought it was neuropathy, but kind of ruled that out. And so they're just trying to figure all of that out. And so she is facing more tests. So let's continue to pray for Betty. And I know that she would be thrilled if the Lord would just choose to heal her. And so let's just pray the Lord would work in Betty's life and give her a physical touch. Let's also pray for Mike Erie. Mike Erie goes in the morning to get his cataract removed. So let's remember him. And there are a couple of others that are facing the same kind of surgery. But let's pray for Mike in the morning. The Lord would help him during that procedure. Linda Scott tells me that she's having some trouble with her back as well. Going to have an MRI. And not sure exactly what it is. She's too young to what is it called? Arthritis. That's the word I'm looking for. She's too young to have that. But thinking that maybe could be some arthritis on the spine or whatever. And so let's remember Linda as she faces that test. I want us to also pray for the Mann family. And I know they made a trip out to Kansas for a funeral in the last couple of weeks. And we want to continue to remember them as we pray together this morning. Let's also pray for our pastor and all the other workers at Seabreeze Camp. And I'm not sure if you tuned into any of the services, but some wonderful truths that have been presented. And let's continue to pray. I think Brother Stetler is preaching this morning. So let's remember him as he preaches. And then throughout this week, I know that he appreciates the prayer of his home church. And so let's do our best to be remembering him as we pray. We also want to pray for our nation. A lot has been going on in our world this week, and we just want to pray the Lord would give our leaders wisdom and direction. And whether the ones in leadership are your party or not, we all want God's wisdom and God's leadership to be given to them. And it's our responsibility as God's people to pray for those. And so let's be praying the Lord would give them the leadership and the wisdom that they need to govern this nation. I would also mention something from the state level. Very soon there's going to be a bill introduced in Kentucky. The Abolish Abortion Bill is going to be introduced very, very shortly, February the 17th. And so let's be praying right here in our own country, right here in our own state, the state where Jesus was possibly born. We don't know for sure. But let's pray that righteousness would prevail, and that God's will would be done, and God would lead and direct our legislature. Let's also remember our Ukraine. That's the other one, I guess, that Brother Tim Sedlicek has mentioned to me. Let's continue to remember the ongoing issues there. The Lord would give special help. Are there any spoken requests that you'd like to mention? Yes, Brother George. Let's do remember George's friend and in all of the details of that trip. Well, good for you. Good for you. And let's pray the Lord will continue to use George to impact this lady. And you know, it's awful nice just to be neighborly, isn't it? You have anybody around you that you're being neighborly to? It's really important. That is really where oftentimes the seeds of the gospel are planted, just by being friends and establishing relationships and then impacting them with the gospel. And so I appreciate George being friendly to his neighbor, but let's all work in those avenues that God opens up for us. Yes, Sister Hill. Remember Sister Hill's neighbor's daughter. The Lord would give direction and physical touch. Amen. Yes, Brother Jim. All right, let's pray for the Sedernas making the trip to Wisconsin. The Lord would give them traveling mercies as they labor there. Amen. All right, yes. All right, let's remember Shamika's aunt as we pray. Let's also remember the Winkler's friend, Keith. The Lord knows all about those needs. Maybe you have unspoken requests you'd like to mention. God knows every one of those needs. I'm so glad there is no small issues with God. To us, we kind of categorize them. But they're all important to God. And so we can take these needs to Him. Trust that He will give special help. Let's stand together. Brother David will lead us. Let's join with him. Let's not let him pray alone, but let's pray with him as he leads us to the throne of grace.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. Thank you for the opportunity to come into your presence and for your presence of being here with us, Lord. Lord, we're unworthy of your presence, Lord. We're thankful that you gave your Son to die for us, to give us salvation, Lord. Thank you to be there for us. As we sang earlier, I'm so glad I gave my heart to you, Lord. I feel so glad you took me in.
We want to thank you, Lord, that you want to care about each one of us.
Lord, the master of the universe, the one that created everything that we see, who created us, Lord, wants to be with us.
want you to know that our faith, our trust, and confidence to talk to you. Some trust in horses and some trust in chariots.
We don't understand many of those things.
The scripture says, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God.
You care. You hear our prayer requests. Lord, we think about the mentioning of being a neighbor, being the light of the world, and some reason of representing the law about us, spiritual around us, medical, something doesn't change their head.
Financial, emotional, relational, we pray for national needs,
reach out for our loved you, Lord.
Settlers of the Lord that are this morning, we pray to see reasoning out here.
Oh God, pray for the anointing, Holy Spirit, ultimately, after each one,
you can give,
totally surrender their heart and their life to you, Lord.
God, we recognize
that one in so many of these areas.
Things about concerns.
There's nothing that we can do about it.
Oh, our hands really are tied, but yet we put our faith in you.
And the
prayer is just as big as God is.
Prayer
is just as strong as God is strong. So, Lord, as we engage in prayer, we can move the hand of God and
help him do his will here.
Whatever the reason,
pray that you would
trust him. We hear that and help him, Lord.
We're trusting you,
blessed
Holy Spirit,
to come and do your word
there,
even in this service.
Travel and help him
pray in the special singing about the preaching of your word.
We pray, oh God,
pray that you would be with power and anointing.
Would you give us
open ears and open hearts
so that we can hear
God, we're trusting.
Lord, we pray that all across our
world, who we're
trusting, Lord, we pray that your presence would be felt
and help the response to be that we want to come draw closer to you,
enjoy a better life for you, Lord.
We pray for
our
nation.
We pray for this bill
and all
of your way
in Kentucky,
Lord. We pray that you undertake
and
help that to pass, Lord.
We pray for
the
situation in Ukraine.
Oh,
Lord, there's a lot of trouble in the world, but we know that you have control.
Lord, we can't see the future,
but we come to you.
We commit it to you.
And Lord, we pray that you'd help each of us to listen to your voice,
because your voice will lead us the right way and lead us to be with you forever for all that you do.
Brother David, for leading us this morning. Appreciate his presence as we have prayed together. We're planning to come to you for the morning offering in just a moment, but before the ushers are preparing to come, I want to just mention that we are, as I alluded to last Sunday and Wednesday night, we're going to take just a moment of time here in the service this morning to lift pledges for our missions giving. And so we at this church support three different missionaries, and that is the Jeremy Nestor Hopkins, that's the Cressman family, and the Melton family. And Kendrick is here this morning. We're supporting his family there in Honduras. And so we have, at least in the past, now let me back up and first of all say, if you feel like this is happening rather quickly, last year we kind of did it later in the year, like halfway through. So if you feel like this time has come around rather quickly, it's because it is. And we're trying to get back on schedule. We do it typically at the first of the year, around the first of the year. And so it probably seems a little faster than normal. But what we have done is we have pledged $400 to be split and given to our three different missionaries. And so what we basically try to do is just lift an offering and or lift pledges, rather raise pledges, to try to cover that $400 that we give to the missionaries. If you do not give, if we do not raise enough to give them $400 a month, then we will give them what you pledge. If we go beyond $400, we will give them what you pledge. And so basically what we have done is we've just taken a spot in the service, just allow you to raise one finger for $10 or two fingers. So if you raise a hand like this, that's five, all right? I'm counting five. But typically that's the way we've done. Now, if you feel a little nervous about giving that way, if you want to text the amount you want to give per month to myself, I can take that as well. You can get your phones out and be prepared to do that. But if you are interested in giving $10, $20, $30, $40 a month for us to raise collectively to send the money to our missionaries, I would begin counting numbers, and I'm going to have Brother Scott, if he'll come up here and help me just a moment so we can make sure we get the right total so we don't lose count. Anybody want to go ahead and tell us quickly what you plan to give each month? All right, there's five there. Two there, seven, eight, nine, 10, 12 and a half. Okay. Well, that's for my numbers, I'm counting 12 and a half. And then, Brother Doug, what do you do? I'm sorry. Okay. That's 16 and a half. Anybody else? All right. 21 and a half. 22 and a half. 24 and a half. All right. 26 and a half. 28 and a half. 30 and a half. All right. This is great. Thank you so very much. I guess I didn't need you at all. 32 and a half. I'm just teasing you. 32 and a half. I'm only teasing. All right. All right. Four more. 36 and a half. I think I got you, Nikita. Thank you. All right. 36 and a half. Two more. 38 and a half. All right. All right. Five. 43 and a half. Okay, I think we've reached the amount right here this morning. I thank you so very much. Anybody else quickly before I tell Scott to sit down? All right, thank you, Scott. All right, so we've got 43 and a half. So that translates into about $4,300, $4,350, something like that. And so that is that right? Am I 430 plus five. All right, so we're going to do that again next Sunday. There's probably some that will be here next Sunday that were not here this morning that want to get in on that. And if you want to do a pledge as well, and I received also a pledge on text of 10, so it's 44 and a half. Anybody else want to get on that, you can certainly do that. And an auction from the pool. Just don't make me use my auction voice. Okay, I do sincerely, from the bottom of my heart, appreciate your giving, and that is a huge blessing, and some of you, no doubt, having been raised on the mission field, know the benefit of the local church supporting you, and so you know that firsthand, but what a privilege it is to be a blessing to those, and I appreciate it, and again, we'll take time next Sunday as well, just to see if there's anybody that was not here that wants to get involved. Thank you so very much. All right, the ushers are coming at this time. Wait on you for the morning tithes and offerings. The Lord bless you as you worship in your giving at this time.
Thank you for your giving. I think I did a little calculation, and what we have right now is $465 a month That's great. So next Sunday we can do that again, and we'll be giving the missionaries quite a nice sum, I hope. By way of announcements, tonight is our regular service at 6 o'clock, but before that, at 5:15, is youth service. We'll be preparing for the youth involvement service that is happening tonight, and Faith Builders Plus, college and career age, over at the Strouds, is that also at 5:15. We have a few announcements that we want to remember this morning. The 10th is the February date night, so take advantage of that. I think the Loper family, my family, will be bringing Colton. I'm just kidding. I had that planned a while. All right. So the February date night, you want to take advantage of that. And Pastor Stroud has something planned that he's going to give to the couples that come, that you can ask questions to each other, and that will be an exciting time, I hope. The 19th is a service, Sunday evening service with UBC, service of music, and the 21st is Senior and Friends at 11:30 at Golden Corral on Houston Road, I believe. And then the 24th is also another opportunity to have a date night, so you can take advantage of both of those times. Amen? All right. And then the 28th is a ladies' fellowship evening, and I'm not sure what's involved there, but you can ask Sherilyn, I guess, about that. Then, coming up in March, March 9th, is a day trip to bus convention. We want to support that, and so we want you to be involved, and we will be taking the bus over to Indianapolis area, Westfield, for the bus convention. I believe that covers all the announcements. If I missed anything, it's right here in your bulletin, and you can look at that. At this time, the Rayfelts are coming to favor us with a number of songs.
Thank you.
Rayfelt family for that wonderful reminder this morning. And nothing beats family harmony. And I certainly enjoyed the singing and the message of that song. Let me mention just a couple other things. I wanted to highlight a couple of things. On the back of your bulletin is the Friend and Family Focus Month, and I told Scott that I would put a little plug in for this. I wanted you to be aware, we've done this, let's see here, at least last year, we've done Friend and Family Focus Sundays for quite a while, but the last year was the first year that we made it the entire month of March. And so we are doing that again, and so if you're looking at the back of your bulletin, that will be the Sundays, March the 5th, the 12th, the 19th, and the 26th. And so we want you to be thinking about your family or friends that you have. And, of course, we welcome anybody, any of your family or any of your friends. But I guess our target really is trying to get new people into our church that we can try to do our best to affect them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we encourage you to find those that maybe neighbors or somebody you work with or whatever. We already have some people in our mind who we want to invite. And we typically have postcards to give you. We'd like to do it a month ahead of time. But we went to the place where we hold our postcards, and evidently we're out of them. We must have finished them off last year and did not reorder them. So we're a little behind schedule on that. We'll try to get those to you right away so that you can have those. But in the meantime, before we have the postcards, be thinking about who you need to be inviting. And we want this month of March to be impacting to our communities. And so we're asking you to be thinking about that and be praying. I know I mentioned it some time ago, but Brother Witt had mentioned when he taught last Sunday about praying for 10 people to be saved. And he followed that up with a phone call and early this week, I guess, and said, as a result of that year when their church was praying for 10 people to be saved, 10 people were saved. And I think that is just beautiful. And now, not all of them necessarily maybe ended up going to their church, but some of them may have gotten converted on their deathbed or whatever. But 10 individuals that they were connected with that year had given their heart to the Lord. And I just think it's important for us to be praying that way as well. We have Friend and Family Focus Month coming, as I've just announced. And I think it's important for us to be praying that the Lord would help us and direct us who we need to be impacting and inviting. And that lives will be changed by the power of the gospel. We can't do that, friends. We can't change their lives, but we can introduce them to the one who can. And so you be much in prayer about the Friend and Family Focus Month. I also wanted to mention Faith Builders Plus. He mentioned that, but I wanted just to, I had Felicia on tap to give a little plug for it. And but she thought her voice was a little raspy. And so anyway, I'm just going to let her sit it out. But she is going to be doing a save her voice for tonight, because she is going to be sharing in the month of February. Sherilyn and Felicia together are going to be working together on talking about the names of God. And so I know that that will be a study that you will want to participate in. So all of you young people and young couples and those of you that would identify with the college and career bracket, we want you to be there at the parsonage at 5:15, and typically there's some sort of snack and coffee or whatever, but we want to study together, and so we're looking forward to that throughout the month of February. And then March, there'll be another theme that's up and coming. All right, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to invite you to open them once again to the book of Galatians. The book of Galatians. How many of you caught what I said last week, or actually a couple weeks prior? It took me a couple times to get through this message, but how many of you were conscious or awake enough to hear me say I was finishing or I was close to finishing the series? Okay, I've come back for one more message from Galatians, this series, Essentials for Spiritual Living. Let me recap the previous message I titled. Some of you were not here last week. Some of you were gone to Central Pennsylvania Youth Convention. We'll look forward to that report tonight in tonight's service. But let me recap that previous message I titled, The Encumbrances to Spiritual Living. I won't give the entire illustration again this morning, but I gave the illustration of the man who was hired by the city to keep the debris out of the stream. You remember the illustration? Thinking that this was not a very important job, or maybe it was just too much money for that type of job, they fired him from that position, and consequently the water and the entire village suffered for their decision. Using that as a spiritual analogy, we need to take inventory of our spiritual stream every now and then, don't we? We just need to assess our own spiritual life to see if there is any debris that prevents us from the spiritual life God wants us to have. God has a plan. God has a goal. He wants your spiritual life to be unpolluted. He wants your spiritual life to be unhindered. And so every now and then we need to take inventory to see how we're doing. Galatians chapter 5 helped us with that. We noticed several encumbrances. First of all, we noticed the encumbrance of scriptural philosophies of two things. Number one, legalism, which bases your salvation on what we do rather than what God did. There's the unscriptural philosophy of lawlessness, which says we have the freedom to do anything we want since Christ has made us free. Both of these extreme philosophies will negatively affect your spiritual stream. We noted, secondly, the encumbrance of people that hinder us in our spiritual walk. Verse number 7, if you have your Bibles open to Galatians 5, you can see that, verse number 7. The encumbrance, thirdly, we mentioned the encumbrance of pillaging personal characters. Paul spoke in verse 15 of biting and devouring one another. Fourthly, we noted the encumbrance of the products of the flesh. Paul gives a list of these in verses 19 to 21. And then finally, we noted the encumbrance of personal choices. Paul wrote in verse 26, "Let us not be." In other words, the choice remains within ourselves. So we take that inventory, we go back to the illustration. As the town realized the benefit of the man's services, they hired him back. Things went back to the way they were supposed to be. And in the conclusion, I talked about two types of things that can create debris in our spiritual life. Sin certainly pollutes our spiritual stream. Don't ever forget it. If you have sin in your life, you can't just rock along with the notion that everything is okay in your life. It's not. You must repent. You must confess that to God. Secondly, we mentioned that stuff can prevent you from experiencing and enjoying the spiritual life God wants you to have. I mentioned that we often go through the ebb and flow of taking on stuff and removing stuff in our spiritual life. And this is what makes revival necessary. So we sometimes allow busyness or wrong focuses, etc., to affect our spiritual experience. So through the aid of the Holy Spirit, He begins to work in our lives. And thankfully, we have a faithful Holy Spirit who is in the business of keeping our spiritual stream without pollution, without hindrance. And if there's sin or if there's stuff that is hindering our spiritual life, He stands ready. He stands ready to not only point it out to us, but also to remove it as we allow Him to do it. In this final message of this series, I want to talk about the essential for spiritual living. You say, "Andrew, that's been the title of this series all along." Well, you're not incorrect, and I believe that all I've covered in this series are essential elements for spiritual living. No one will deny that walking in the Spirit or being led of the Spirit or living in the Spirit, sowing to the Spirit, possessing the fruit of the Spirit, removing the hindrances in our life are all essential. None of us would deny that this morning. But having said that, there is what I'm calling the essential for spiritual living. What I'm going to talk about for a few moments this morning in this final message is an absolute necessity if we want to continually maintain our spiritual walk with God. As I thought about this series, I really became disappointed that there was not a message on the importance of being filled with the Spirit. We talked about being led of the Spirit and walking in the Spirit, all of those important aspects of our spiritual life. But there was nothing that really spoke of the component of a second work that happens in the life of the believer. And I really didn't see this in this truth in chapter 5. And so I thought, how am I? And I think the concept was there in Galatians chapter 2, where Paul talks about being crucified. Yet not I, but Christ liveth within me. So there's that concept there. But as I was trying to think about this series and tying it together with the Spirit, I wasn't quite sure that I was seeing it. And so I sat down this week and began reading through the book of Galatians again, and I ran across another interesting verse that mentioned the Spirit. It's in chapter 3 of Galatians. I was excited to read this verse, and I believe it speaks to this vital truth. If you have your Bibles handy, let's look at this chapter briefly for a few moments. Galatians chapter 3. In verse number 2, Paul asks a rhetorical question that highlights the importance of faith in our spiritual life. Now, Paul has kind of set out on a journey in defense of faith versus the law. Faith versus works. And so he set out as an argument to these people that he's writing to. This church has no doubt had people come in that's trying to influence them. Influence, as I've already talked about in Galatians chapter 5. Influence them to take on the ceremonial law again. Christ freed them from that law, of the ceremony law. And so now there's people from Jerusalem that are coming and trying to influence them again, saying, you need to add this to your faith. And Paul here is emphasizing in this chapter the function of faith. He asked them a rhetorical question. He says, received you, this is in verse 2, he says, received you the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? He continues in verse 3, continuing asking questions. He said, are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Again, you have to understand who he's writing to. Those that have experienced freedom in Christ, and now they're being influenced by these. He says, are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, are ye now being made perfect? Are you being made perfect by the flesh? Paul then uses an example for them to consider. He uses the example of Abraham, and he says in verse number 6, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. In other words, it's not what Abraham did, it was his faith. But his faith then translated into action. Everybody understand that? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Jump now to verse 11. Paul says, he's continuing his defense. Paul says, no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. And he says, it is evident. In other words, Paul is trying to make this very clear. No man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, he said. Then he says, for the just shall live by what? The just shall live by faith. Right after this, Paul reminds them that those who were trying to add the ceremonial laws, the Levitical laws, as a basis for their salvation, Paul reminds them that the law is not of faith. In fact, Paul even uses the Old Testament to make his point. He says, the man that doeth them shall live in them, or shall live by them. In other words, it's either one way or the other. It's not both. But notice what Paul says. He says in verses 13 and 14, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. In other words, the way of faith through Christ became available to all men, Jew and Gentile, bond and free. The way of faith through Christ became available to all. Now notice the last phrase of this verse. Paul says, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. In verses 6 to 9, we see that Abraham's blessing was justification by faith. And now a further benefit of Christ's redemption is that we have the promise of the Spirit through faith. The Hebrew writer put it this way: wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. The redemption of Christ provides access to the promise of the Spirit. Listen to me, friend. Calvary produced the privilege of Spirit-filled living. Jesus died so that we can have the promise of the Spirit. Oh, friend, we dare not live below this privilege that God gives for us. Back in our scripture passage in Galatians 3, Paul moves quickly past this important statement. He continues, just kind of mentions it in passing, and he continues his argument that he's making to his readers, the point that he's making. But we, friends, here this morning, we need to stop at that point for a little while and consider this for our few remaining moments. While the emphasis in this passage is on faith, Paul is making a very, very important point about faith. We dare not miss, as we zoom past it in our reading, we dare not miss what it is that's available to us through this faith. It's through faith we can receive the promise of the Spirit. What's the promise of the Spirit which Paul speaks? Looking with some different authors, I think we can see in this verse an allusion to what Pentecost provided. We see Paul almost pointing his readers back to what had happened some time ago in Jerusalem. What better place to go for a discussion on this essential for spiritual living than in Acts chapter 1 and 2. In verse 4 of Acts chapter 1, Luke, who is writing the book of Acts, records Jesus' words to the disciples. And he says, "Wait for the promise of the Father, which ye have heard of me." Jesus here is essentially saying, "I have talked with you about this subject previously." Can't you just hear that as he says these things? "Ye have heard of me," which ye have heard of me. Jesus alludes to the time he's talked to them previously. He says, "In our time together, as we've walked together, as we've discussed things together, I have spoken to you concerning these things." So what had Jesus promised? Well, let's look at a few of them. You can turn to them if you'd like, or you can just follow along as we look at these passages. John chapter 7, verses 37 to 39, we read these words: "In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, 'If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.'" But then we have this parenthetical insert in verse 39. It says, "But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believed on him should receive." Why? For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Here, the thought is clearly expressed to us. When Jesus is ascended, when Jesus goes up, the Holy Spirit could come down. Jesus here is telling the disciples about the promise of the Spirit that would be given. It had not been given to them yet. He said, "I must go up before the Spirit comes down." John chapter 14, we find a few verses there. Verses 25 and 26 read this way: "These things have I spoken unto you, being," this is Jesus, "being yet present with you," he says in verse number 26, "but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father," what does it say next? You probably don't have your Bibles open there, but "whom the Father," it says, "will send in my name. He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." Notice the promise Jesus gives about the Spirit. He says, "The Father will send him." That sounds like the promise of the Spirit to me, doesn't it to you? John 14:16. And I will pray the Father. Catch the promise. I will pray the Father, and he, what? Shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. We turn the page and we look at John chapter 15. Jesus again says, but when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father. Jesus also assumes partial responsibility in this verse. Not only will the Father send the promise, he says, I will send him to you from the Father. Who is it? Jesus said, the Comforter is the Spirit of truth. The next page, John chapter 16, verse number 7. Nevertheless, he says, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, what? I will send him unto you. The promised Spirit. Verse 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. This verse, the promise is inferred through the words of Jesus. He says, when he has come. One more, Luke chapter 24 and verse 49. Jesus said, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Pretty clear language. The resurrected Christ clearly tells the disciples before he ascends, I will send the promise. These were the words of Jesus to his followers during his 3 short years with them. And over again, Jesus had communicated that the Spirit would come. And now in this final encounter in Acts chapter 1, Jesus essentially says to the disciples, he says, I have spoken about the Spirit to you many times before. I have promised the Spirit is coming. And since I'm ascending back to heaven, the Spirit will be sent. He will be given. Now wait for him to come. Jesus continues in verse 5 and says, he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. In this verse, Jesus indicates to the disciples that it will only be a short time before the promised Spirit is given. And now let's jump to chapter 2 and see what happens. Acts chapter 2, beginning with verse 1, says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Friend, this is the record of the promised Spirit of which Jesus had been promising to give to the disciples. You say, preacher, what is happening here? What's going on? Weren't the disciples already saved? Weren't they already following Jesus? What is this all about? This is a second experience that Jesus knew the disciples needed. If you were to read the Gospels and Jesus' interaction with the disciples, you'd quickly find out that their spiritual experience was lacking something. Wouldn't you agree? There were times bickering among one another, vying for positions, times vindictive in spirit, asking Jesus to call down fire on this city. There were certain evidences of something that was lacking. So you ask, what happened to those in the upper room on this day of Pentecost? What did the promised Spirit of which Jesus promised to send? What did the promised Spirit accomplish? I would suggest 3 things this morning. Quickly, we'll run through them. First, there was a purifying of the sin nature. Let me try to explain it this way. God has provided a twofold remedy for a twofold need in the human heart. First of all, God provided a work in the human heart for our sins to be forgiven. Oh, we thank God for the new birth, don't we? We thank God for the transformation that takes place, that makes us a new creature, that translates us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Oh, the difference as a result of that new birth when Jesus transforms us, sets us on a different path. But secondly, not only does God provide a work in the human heart for the sins we've committed to be forgiven, secondly, God provides a work in the human heart for the nature we were born with that caused us to sin in the first place. What does David say? Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. So there's this nature on the inside. It's been said, and I guess it's worth repeating, and it's kind of a play on words, but you have to understand it. But it says, we're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. Got to sometimes pause and think about that. Which came first? We're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we're sinners. The disciples had decided to follow Christ. They had allowed Jesus to transform their lives. He had called them, and they forsook everything, the gospel accounts tell us. Jesus said, come, follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. And they left everything. They forsook their nets, and they followed Christ. There was a transformation. Something took place in their life. But those same disciples needed the promised Spirit to purify their hearts from the nature of sin. And that's exactly what he did. If you were to turn to Acts chapter 15 and verse 9, Peter connects another situation that has happened in the book of Acts with what transpired on the day of Pentecost. And he links them together and says, their hearts were purified by faith. So you say, Andrew, what does the promised Spirit accomplish? What is one of the essentials for spiritual living? You must allow the promised Spirit to purify your heart of the nature of sin. We can't pass up that word faith, right? That's what Paul has mentioned in Galatians chapter 3. The promise of the Spirit comes by faith. There is a purifying of the sin nature that deals with the thing that caused you to sin in the first place. Oh, I just want to push pause this morning and say that God has always had a remedy for the sinful heart. God's not wringing his hands saying, what are we going to do about this? No, and Jesus wasn't plan B. From the foundation of the world, Christ was slain. That has been the remedy. What Christ has done, he suffered without the gate that he might sanctify us. The whole process is a result of what Christ has done on the cross. So there's the purifying of the sin nature. The second thing the promised Spirit did was a pouring in of his Spirit. Verse 4 of Acts chapter 2 tells us they were filled with the Holy Ghost. The promised Spirit that Jesus spoke about and Paul in our opening passage alludes to has been poured out on those in the upper room. And we'll get to waiting in just a moment, but I'm confident that prior to this filling of the promised Spirit that the Spirit wanted to fill the disciples with, there was some emptying of themselves in preparation for the filling. And when God saw that the time was right, he poured out his Spirit in his fullness. The promised Spirit is a filling of that Spirit in the human heart. Friend, I just want you to know on this Sunday morning that God's goal is for us to be filled with his promised Spirit. It's not God's goal for us to live empty. It is God's goal for us to be filled with his Spirit. Thirdly, the promised Spirit brought about a power for service. We see this promise by Jesus in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. This power would empower them to be witnesses for Christ. Jesus said on that occasion they would be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. It started where they were all at in Jerusalem, and then it would spread from there. And you keep reading the book of Acts, and we see this power displayed over and over again. The lives of the disciples, as they even as they got busy with the demands of life, they stopped, they prayed, they were filled again with the Spirit, and God used them to continue to change their world wherever God placed them. Friend, I want to tell you that the promised Spirit still gives us power to fulfill the tasks God has assigned to us. You might feel like God is asking you to do something you can't do. You might feel like that assignment is too large for me. I'm too small of a person to accomplish what God is asking me to accomplish. Friend, I want you to know the promised Spirit gives you the power to do what God is asking you to do. You say, I recognize this need for the promised Spirit in my life. But how do I get it? Well, there are many things, I guess, that could be said at this juncture, but let me offer a twofold response. First, I would simply suggest there must be a desire. I see this desire playing out in Acts chapter 1. Jesus said in verse number 4, he said, wait for the promise. The Greek word there for late literally means stay around. Jesus is telling the disciples, I want you to stay around in Jerusalem until you receive the promised Spirit. This great command from Jesus to wait momentarily trumped the Great Commission. Jesus was saying to the disciples, this baptism of the Holy Spirit, this promised Spirit is so important for your life and for your ministry that before you do anything else, you must wait for that which I promised you. I can imagine the disciples ready to go. Can't you? They had been witnesses to the resurrection. Jesus had died. He had risen again. It was this man that could transform lives. They wanted to go, and God had told them to go into all the world and preach the gospel. But before they could go, Jesus said, I want you to tarry. I want you to wait. Luke 24, Jesus reiterates that to the disciples. He said, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. I read that a few moments ago. But then he says, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Very often the word for tarry is translated with the idea of being seated or to sit or sitting, sat down, etc. But there's another time when it is used differently. In Acts chapter 18, Paul has been laboring the city of Corinth. And in verse 11, Luke tells us that Paul continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. That word for continued in verse 11 is the same word Jesus used when he said tarry. You say, does that have any significance? I believe it does. Because I believe Jesus was essentially saying to the disciples, it's important for you to continue doing what you have been doing in Jerusalem until the Spirit descends on you. Now, take this word continue and turn back to Acts chapter 1. And in verse 12, it says, then returned they into Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. So they take the admonition of the Lord. They go back to Jerusalem from the Mount of Olivet. And verse number 14 says, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. The word there in verse number 14 for continued can be translated, wait on. These all waited with one accord. And here's what I would say about this. These disciples were not being lethargic about the command of Jesus to wait for the Spirit of promise. They weren't being lethargic about it. They were eagerly waiting for the Spirit to descend. Verse 14 tells us they were with one accord, unanimous in prayer and petitions. So from these remarks, we can conclude that Jesus was passionate about the disciples receiving the promised Spirit. And the disciples were passionate about receiving the promise of the Holy Spirit. The waiting in their lives was the outflow of a desire to receive what Jesus had promised. Jesus says, I will send. You must wait. And they waited. I don't know that the time factor has all that much to do with it, because I believe once faith connects, and God knows the heart, and you've made the submission, I don't think it has to be a long, drawn-out process, but what I think this scripture shows us is that they were desiring and eager and seeking and waiting and had it at the top of their priority so that they could receive the promise of the Spirit that Jesus had promised. The waiting was the outflow of a desire. The second thing I would mention is faith. If you're going to receive the promise of the Spirit, you're going to have to exercise faith. Both Acts 15 and Galatians chapter 3 speak about the Spirit's coming to the heart as a result of faith. You must engage your faith. You must believe God to give you the promised Spirit, just as He did on the day of Pentecost. What does Paul tell us other places? Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. So this final message on the essential for spiritual living is simply a call for you to experience and then live with the benefits of the promised Spirit. The promised Spirit who purifies the sin nature. The promised Spirit who pours Himself into the life with His fullness. The promised Spirit who gives you power for service. Closing, I just want to ask you this question. Have you had that moment when you received the promise of the Spirit? Maybe someone here would say, I know I've been saved. I know I've been transformed. I know I've made the decision and confessed and repented. I know I'm a follower of Christ, but I can't say that I know I've received the promise of the Spirit. Can I tell you, He wants to do it for you. He wants to give you the promise. He wants to give you the promise of the Spirit that He promised to the disciples that they received on the day of Pentecost. The promised Spirit of Galatians 3 dwelling in your heart is the essential element that will enable you to experience really the realities of all the other elements found in Galatians 5 and 6. You got to have the promised Spirit if you're going to continue to live in the Spirit. You got to have the promised Spirit if you're going to walk in the Spirit. You're going to have the fullness of the Spirit to continue to be led of the Spirit. It's absolutely essential that you allow the Spirit to come in His fullness. Friend, I just want to tell you on this Sunday morning, don't attempt to live your spiritual life without the promised Spirit. It will only produce frustrations and failure. But we can live victoriously. We can live our spiritual life with the promised Spirit. I want us to stand together for just a moment, every head bowed, every eye closed, just a couple minutes after 12. Not a strong pull, no music, no singing. Just waiting a moment. Maybe there's somebody here that would say, Pastor Andy, I recognize I need the promised Spirit in my life. Can I tell you, it will be the essential for your spiritual living. It will be the key in your life to living a consistent, victorious spiritual life. Oh, friend, don't live beneath your privileges. Christ's death has provided it and made it possible for you. Live with the promised Spirit. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you that we've been able to look at your word together. I pray that you will take this feeble attempt of mine and somehow translate it into ways that the hearer can hear and apply to their life. You know every heart here, every need that's here. If there's somebody here that would recognize they're not living with the promised Spirit and the fullness of your Spirit on them, I pray that you will continue to speak to their heart, continue to give them a heart that is willing to seek, a heart that's willing to wait for the promised Spirit in their lives. Bless us now as we go our separate ways, and we'll give you praise in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You are dismissed.